Hachette Audio presents Zonal Martins, From Ajax to Zidane, The Making of Modern Soccer. Written by Michael Cox. Read by Colin Mace.
Introduction. Despite this book's chronological nature, it was not originally intended to be a history of modern European football. The primary intention was to analyse the various playing styles that dominate Europe's seven most influential footballing countries. The Netherlands, Italy, France, Portugal, Spain, Germany, and England. A fairly unarguable septet, based on a combination of recent international performance and the current strength of their domestic leagues. A nation's footballing style is reflected in various ways. It's not simply about the national side's characteristics, but about the approach of its dominant clubs, the nature of its star players, and the philosophy of its coaches. It's about the experiences of a country's players when moving abroad, and about the success of its imports. It's about how referees officiate and what the supporters cheer. That's what this book was always going to be about. But then came the issue of structure. In which order should the countries be covered? Geographically? Thematically? By drawing balls out of bowls at UEFA's headquarters? It immediately became clear that the story wasn't simply about the different style of each country. It was also about how Europe's dominant football country and dominant style had changed so regularly. 1992 was the obvious start date, heralding the backpass law, the rebranding of the European Cup to Champions League, and the formation of the Premier League. From that point, each country could be covered in turn by focusing on a four-year period of success. In the early 1990s, the Dutch footballing philosophy was worshipped across the continent, but its influence declined after the Bosman ruling. The baton passed to Italy, which clearly boasted Europe's strongest league. But then France started winning everything at international level, and its national academy became the template for others, before suddenly, almost out of nowhere, Europe's most revered player and manager both hailed from Portugal. Next, Barcelona and Spain won across the board during a very obvious four-year period of dominance, before tiki-taka's decline meant Bayern and Germany took control. Finally, Europe's most successful coaches found themselves competing in England, introducing various styles to the Premier League. Naturally, each section strays outside these four-year boundaries. You can't analyse Dutch football in the mid-1990s without relating it back to the total football of the 1970s, and you can't analyse Didier Deschamps' performances for France at the turn of the century without noting that he won the World Cup as manager in 2018. None of the chapters are named after specific individuals or teams from each period. They're based around more general concepts that have been reflected in each nation's football over a longer period. The seven sections are different in style. The Netherlands section is about how the Dutch dictated the nature of modern European football. The Italy section focuses on specific tactical debates, and the France section is about its production of certain types of player. The Portugal section is about its evolution into a serious footballing force. The Spain section about its commitment to a specific philosophy. The Germany section about its reinvention, and the England section about how it borrows concepts from elsewhere. By virtue of the book structure, some noteworthy teams aren't covered extensively here. There are only passing mentions of Greece's shock Euro 2004 triumph, Italy's World Cup success 2 years later, and Real Madrid's Champions League winning sides of recent years. But the most influential players, coaches, and teams since 1992 feature heavily, and therefore, while it wasn't the original intention, this book hopefully serves as a history of modern European football, by outlining its crucial innovations, including gegenpressing, playing out from the back, tactical periodization, tiki-taka, and, of course, zonal marking. Part 1. Voetbal, 1992 to 96. Chapter 1. Individual versus collective. At the start of football's modern era, in the summer of 1992, Europe's dominant nation was the Netherlands. The European Cup had just been lifted by a Barcelona side led by Johan Cruyff, the epitome of the Dutch school of total football, while Ajax had won the European Cup Winners' Cup. And there was strength in depth domestically. PSV had won the league. Feyenoord won the cup. Holland failed to retain the European Championship, having won it in 1988, but played exciting, free-flowing football at an otherwise disappointingly defensive Euro 92, the last tournament before the back pass change. Europe's most dominant player was also a Dutchman. That year's Ballon d'Or was won by Marco van Basten, while his strike partner at international level, Dennis Bergkamp, finished third. But the Dutch dominance wasn't about specific teams or individuals. It was about a particular philosophy. And Dutch sides, or those coached by Dutch managers like Cruyff, promoted this approach so successfully that football's modern era would be considered in relation to the classic Dutch interpretation of the game. When total football revolutionised the sport during the 1970s, the nature of the approach was widely associated with the nature of Amsterdam. The Dutch capital was the centre of European liberalism, a mecca for hippies from all across the continent, and that was reflected in Dutch football. Ajax and Holland players supposedly had no positional responsibilities and were seemingly allowed to wander wherever they pleased to create vibrant, free-flowing, beautiful football. But in reality, the Dutch approach was heavily systematised. Players interchanged positions exclusively in vertical lines up and down the pitch, and if a defender charged into attack, a midfielder and forward were compelled to drop back and cover. In that respect, while players were theoretically granted freedom to roam, in practice they were constantly thinking about their duties in response to the actions of others. In an era when attackers from other European nations were often granted free roles, Ajax and Holland's forwards were constrained by managerial guidelines. Arrigo Sacchi, the great AC Milan manager of the late 1980s, explained it concisely. There has only been one real tactical revolution, and it happened when football shifted from an individual to a collective game, he declared. It happened with Ajax. Since that time, Dutch football has held an ongoing philosophical debate. Should football be individualistic, like the stereotypical depiction of Dutch culture, or be systematised, like the classic total football sides? During the mid-1990s, this debate was epitomised by the rivalry between Johan Cruyff, the golden boy of total football, now coaching Barcelona, and Ajax manager Louis van Gaal, who enjoyed a more prosaic route to the top. Both promoted the classic Ajax model in terms of ball possession and formation, but whereas Cruyff wholeheartedly believed in indulging superstars, van Gaal relentlessly emphasised the importance of the collective. Van Gaal works even more structurally than Cruyff did, observed their shared mentor, Reinus Michels, who had taken charge of those legendary Ajax and Holland sides in the 1970s. There is less room in Van Gaal's approach for opportunism and changes in positions. On the other hand, build-up play is perfected to the smallest detail. The Dutch interpretation of leadership is somewhat complex. The Dutch take pride in their openness and capacity for discussion, which in a footballing context means players sometimes enjoy influence over issues that elsewhere would be the responsibility of the coach. For example, Cruyff sensationally left Ajax for Barcelona in 1973 because Ajax employed a system in which the players elected the club captain and was so offended when voted out that he decamped to the Camp Nou. When you consider Cruyff's subsequent impact at Barcelona, it was a seismic decision and one that owed everything to classic Dutch principles. Dutch players are accustomed to exerting an influence on their manager and helping to formulate tactical plans. As Van Gaal explained of the Ajax system, we teach players to read the game. We teach them to be like coaches, coaches and players alike. We argue and discuss and, above all, communicate. If the opposition's coach comes up with a good tactic, the players look and find a solution, while in many other countries, players instinctively follow the manager's instructions. A team of Dutch players may offer 11 different opinions on the optimum tactical approach, which partly explains why the national side are renowned for constantly squabbling at tournaments. They've always been encouraged to articulate tactical ideas. This inevitably leads to disagreements, and players in the national side only ever seem to agree when they decide to overthrow the coach. Michels, the father of total football, actively encouraged dissent with his so-called conflict model. which involved him luring players into dressing room arguments. "I sometimes deliberately used a strategy of confrontation," he admitted after his retirement. "My objective was to create a field of tension and improve the team's spirit." Crucially, Michael's acknowledged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.